نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربنا زدنا علما. Precept number 57. In religious matters, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is guided by divine revelation, the obedience of which, like the command of Allah, is obligatory. Meaning when it comes to religious affairs, when it comes to religious matters, religious problems, then the Prophet ﷺ, he would not make decisions based on his own wishes. Rather, whatever decisions he made, whatever guidance he gave, whatever instructions he gave were based on revelation. Now when it comes to wahi, when it comes to Qur'an, we are supposed to follow it. So likewise, the decisions, the instructions that came from the Prophet ﷺ, even those we have to follow. Why? Because what's the basis of that? Revelation. The Qur'an, what's the basis of that? Revelation. So the Sunnah also, its basis is revelation. So this is the reason why both we have to observe. عن جابر بن عبد الله يقول مرضت فجاءني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعودني وأبو بكر وهما ماشيان فأتاني وقد أغمي علي فتوضأ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم صب وضوءه علي فأفقت فقلت يا رسول الله وربما قال سفيان فقلت أي رسول الله كيف أقضي في مالي كيف أصنع في مالي قال فما أجابني بشيء حتى نزلت آية الميراث رواه البخاري. Jabir bin Abdullah radiallahu anhu narrated that once I fell ill and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr came on foot to visit me. They found me unconscious. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he did wudu and poured his wudu water on me. I regained consciousness. So you understand what's going on? He was sick. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr, both of them came walking to his house. They didn't come on a ride. They didn't come on an animal. They came walking. And the reason why this is important for us to notice is that if we have to walk somewhere, we find that it's too difficult. We find that it's very inconvenient. That if we can only go somewhere by car, then we'll go. If we don't have a car, then that's it. We won't go at all. But we see that Jabir radhiyallahu anhu was ill and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr, both of them walked all the way to his house to see him, to see how he was doing. And when they found him unconscious, Prophet ﷺ did wudu, and he poured that wudu water on Jabir radhiyallahu anhu, and he regained consciousness. Why do you think he poured his wudu water on him? For the purpose of shifa, and also remember that the wudu of the Prophet ﷺ, barakah in it, which was a source of cure for Jabir radhiyallahu anhu. And also if you think about it, if a person is sick, they have really high fever, they're unconscious, so what's one of the best ways of helping them regain consciousness? Pouring water on them. As soon as he regained consciousness, he said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Sufyan, he said that he may have said ay instead of ya. That Sufyan is one of the narrators. One of the narrators of the hadith. When he narrated the hadith, he said that Jabir radhiyallahu anhu may have said ay instead of ya. If you look at the Arabic, فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَرُبَّمَا قَالَ سُفْيَانُ فَقُلْتُ أَيْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. So Sufyan was not sure if Jabir radhiyallahu anhu said يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ or أَيْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. And this shows us the truthfulness of the narrators. That if they weren't sure about which expression was used, was it يَا or أَيْ, they were so honest that they narrated both of them. They weren't sure which one was it that Jabir said, so he narrated both of them. He said, perhaps he may have said ay instead of ya. So he said that, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, how should I settle my property? What should I do with my wealth? What should I do with my property? How should I deal with it? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not answer me until the ayat of inheritance were revealed. Meaning, Jabir radhiyallahu anhu, his case was slightly different. Typically, you know, people have their children or their parents, so they are the heirs. But Jabir radhiyallahu anhu, he did not have any children, he did not have any parents, he only had siblings. So this is the reason why he asked that, how should I settle my wealth when I die? Who should my wealth go to? Who should I give this wealth to, basically? But we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not answer him until the ayat concerning that particular issue were revealed. And this is the main point of this hadith over here. that the Prophet ﷺ, he did not say by himself that, you know, gift it, give it to somebody, give it all in charity. No. He did not make his own decision. Rather, he waited for the wahi to come. He waited for the revelation. And when that came, then it was the Jabir radiallahu anhu who did what was supposed to be done. We also learn about several other incidents where people came asking the Prophet ﷺ about their problems. And because the Prophet ﷺ did not have a solution immediately, he said to them that I have no solution for you at the moment. And eventually later when the verses were revealed, then they were conveyed to the people. For example, there was once a woman who came to the Prophet ﷺ and she complained to him about her husband who had pronounced zihar on her. And zihar is a kind of divorce in which the man said that you are like the back of my mother, so you're forever forbidden for me. So she wanted an answer. And the Prophet ﷺ had no answer because up until that point, no command had been revealed. So he said to her that I have nothing for you, I don't know what you can do. And then she was sitting there, she did not go away until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verses. And then the Prophet ﷺ told her what to do. So the fact is that whatever the Prophet ﷺ commanded us with, it was not out of his own wish, imagination or desire. No, it was based on revelation. So when that is the case, then his sunnah will be given equal importance as the importance that will be given to the Qur'an. عن سهل بن سعد أن رجلا أتى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا رسول الله أرأيت رجلا رأى مع امرأته رجلا أيقتله فتقتلونه أم كيف يفعل فأنزل الله فيهما ما ذكر في القرآن من التلاعن فقال له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قد قضي فيك وفي امرأتك قال فتلاعنا وأنا شاهد عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ففارقها فكانت سنة أن يفرق بين المتلاعنين رواه البخاري. Sahal bin Sa'd رضي الله عنه narrated that a man came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said, O Messenger of Allah, if any person sees his wife with a stranger, then what should he do? And it's not just seeing him with his wife, but rather this is seeing both of them committing zina. Meaning if a man catches his own wife committing zina with a stranger, then what is that man supposed to do? Because typically, if a person sees someone committing zina, then before saying anything, he has to produce four witnesses. If he does not produce four witnesses, then that person will be punished. It will be considered as though he is accusing the other individual of zina. So before you open your mouth, you have to produce four witnesses. Now this man came to the Prophet ﷺ asking that if a person sees his own wife committing zina, then is he going to go call other people to witness the act? No. And can he remain silent about that? No, because it's his wife, it's his household. If he accuses the wife and he doesn't present witnesses, then he will be punished. And if he takes matters in his own hands, and if he kills who? The man or his wife, then you might inflict capital punishment. On who? The husband. So the husband is in a very difficult situation. He cannot take matters in his own hands, nor can he remain silent in this case. So what should he do? So the Prophet ﷺ did not reply until Allah revealed the command in respect of li'an between them. The Prophet ﷺ did not say anything until the law of li'an was revealed. And what is the law of li'an? It's mentioned in Surah An-Nur, in which the husband and the wife, basically both of them, they bear witness. For example, the husband says, I bear witness, I testify that I saw her committing zina. And several times, a number of times, and the wife also, she either confesses, or if she does not confess, then she will say, I swear by Allah that I did not commit anything. He is of the liars. And if he is truthful, then the curse of Allah be on me. And the husband says that if she is truthful, then the curse of Allah be on me. You understand? So this is why it's called li'an. That you're basically invoking the curse of Allah upon who? On the liar. The husband, if he is accusing the wife wrongly, and on the wife, if she's lying about what she did. So the Prophet ﷺ did not reply until Allah revealed the command of li'an, and then the Messenger of Allah ﷺ told the man that the case of you and your wife has been decided. Consequently, both took part in the process of li'an, and I was present, and they both were separated. Who? The narrator. Sahal ibn Sa'd, he's narrating. So he said that I was present when both of them did li'an on each other, and then at the end, both were separated. Because if the husband accuses the wife four times, he testifies that she committed zina, and may the curse of Allah be on me if I am the liar. And the wife also, she says that no, I did not commit zina, and may the curse of Allah be on me if I am a liar. what to do then? Do they continue in the same relationship? No, then both will be separated. If the woman confesses, then yes, the punishment will be inflicted. But if she does not confess, then what will happen? Both will be separated. So he said that both were separated, and it was a sunnah to separate the two who took part in li'an. So in this hadith also, what do we see? That the Prophet ﷺ did not give a decision out of his own wish. Rather, he waited for the revelation. عن عبد الله رضي الله عنه قال بين أنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حرث وهو متكئ على عسيب إذ مر اليهود فقال بعضهم لبعض سلوه عن الروح فقال ما رأيكم إليه وقال بعضهم لا يستقبلكم بشيء تكرهونه فقالوا سلوه فسألوه عن الروح فأمسك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فلم يرد عليهم شيئا فعلمت أنه يوحى إليه فقمت مقامي فلما نزل الوحي قال ويسألونك عن الروح قل الروح من أمر ربي وما أوتيت من العلم إلا قليلا رواه البخاري. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud narrated that once I was in a garden with the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was resting on the branch of a date palm, meaning he was standing and he was reclining on the branch of a date palm, just like people recline on a stick. And some Jews were passing by, saying to one another, ask him about the soul, ask him about the ruh. So a group of Jews passed by, and when they saw the Prophet ﷺ, they said to each other, ask him about the ruh. One of them, he said, what has put you in doubt about the Messenger of Allah ﷺ? Meaning, why do you want to ask him? The reason why they would ask him different questions was to know if he was truly the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And every time they asked, they got the answers that actually satisfied them. They knew that he was truthful, but they didn't want to accept. So one of them said that, why do you want to ask? You're not going to believe him in any way, so what's the point of asking? Other Jews said that he may say something which might displease you, which might upset you, because that would also happen. That they would come ask him questions, and then when they would get their answers, they wouldn't be happy with those answers. Like once they came, presented him the case of zina, I believe, and the Prophet ﷺ made the same judgment concerning them, that yes, the person had to be punished, and they didn't want that answer, so they were upset. They weren't too happy with the answer. So they said, why do you want to ask him? You're not going to believe in him. And the others said that he might say something that you're not going to like. But some of them then said, ask him, meaning ask him anyway. So they decided to ask the question. Consequently, the Jews asked him that what is the ruh? What is the soul? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was silent and he did not answer them. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that I concluded that something was being revealed to him. Because when he was silent, it was because wahi was being brought to him. He was receiving wahi at that occasion. So I stood up in my place. And when the revelation was complete, he recited the following verse, that they ask you about the soul, say the soul is of the affair of my Lord, and mankind has not been given of knowledge except a little. That you have not been given except very little knowledge, even if you were told in detail about the ruh, you wouldn't fully understand. So it is of the amr of my Lord, meaning it's up to him. He knows what the reality of the ruh is. He gives the ruh and he takes the ruh. So in this hadith also, what do we see? That the Prophet ﷺ did not give the answer himself, but that the revelation came upon him. This is why it's necessary that we follow the sunnah as well. Following the sunnah is also wajib, just like following the Qur'an is wajib. Precept number 58, apart from the Qur'an, Allah also instructed His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam with religious commands. Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not just given the Qur'an, but he was also given other teachings. Therefore, it is obligatory to have faith in them and act upon them the same way as it is obligatory to have faith in the commands of the Qur'an and act upon them. Because both of the teachings, whether it's the Qur'an or the Sunnah, the source is revelation, the source is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in Qur'an we have to follow, then the Sunnah also we have to follow. And the evidence of this is many. That we learn about many commands of the Sharia, which are not mentioned in the Qur'an, but they are mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. عن أنس رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن الله وضع عن المسافر نصف الصلاة والصوم وعن الحبلة والمرضع رواه النسائي. Anas bin Malik رضي الله عنه narrated that the Messenger of Allah ﷺ said that Allah has given leave to the traveler by allowing him to shorten his prayer by half. And he has also given leave to who? The expecting mother and a nursing mother to postpone her fasts. And this detail we don't find in the Qur'an. But where do we find it? In the Sunnah. Especially about the fasting. Okay, that delaying the fasting is permissible for who? The nursing woman as well as the pregnant woman. This is not mentioned in the Qur'an, but we learn about it from the Sunnah. Now of course, the Prophet ﷺ didn't make it up himself. Okay, it would be inconceivable that he would make something up himself of the matters of religion. عن أبي سعيد رضي الله عنه جاءت امرأة إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت يا رسول الله ذهب الرجال بحديثك فاجعل لنا من نفسك يوما نأتيك فيه تعلمنا مما علمك الله. Underline this. فقال اجتمعنا في يوم كذا وكذا في مكان كذا وكذا فاجتمعنا فأتاهن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فعلمهن مما علمه الله ثم قال ما منكن امرأة تقدم بين يديها من ولدها ثلاثة إلا كان لها حجابا من النار فقالت امرأة منهن يا رسول الله أو اثنين قال فأعادتها مرتين ثم قال واثنين 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 رواه البخاري. Beautiful hadith. Abu Sa'id radiallahu anhu narrated that a woman came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, all your teachings have been taken over by men. Meaning, these men come and they learn from you and they surround you all the time and they accompany you all the time and we never get time to ask you to learn from you because men are always there. Think of it as, imagine you're at a class where there is a male instructor. And whenever there's a break or after class, all the brothers go to that scholar, to that instructor, and you're waiting for the brothers to move so that you can go ask your question, and you don't get a chance. Why? Because the instructor, the scholar, is always surrounded by the men. So the women, they, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, even they were like, this is not fair. So one of them, she went up to the Prophet ﷺ and she said, you know, all your teachings have been taken over by men. All of your gatherings of knowledge, the men are always present. So we can never have time, you know, when we can ask you. We can learn from you. So please fix one day in a week for us to come to you for education. In which you can teach us of those matters which Allah has taught you. Appoint for us just one day, okay? And min nafsika, you decide. In the hadith, once a week is not mentioned. So faj'al lana min nafsika yawman, appoint a day, it's up to you, you decide the day, but one day when we will come to you, and in that day, تُعَلِّمُنَا مِمَّا عَلَّمَكَ اللَّهِ. That day you teach us out of that which Allah has taught you. This is very important for us to notice. Okay? Because the women, they were also learning the Qur'an, but they knew that there was more. Okay, there was more besides the Qur'an that the Prophet ﷺ was teaching. There was more that the Prophet ﷺ was given besides the Qur'an. This is why that lady said, that تُعَلِّمُنَا مِمَّا عَلَّمَكَ اللَّهِ. You teach us of that which Allah has taught you. So the Prophet ﷺ said, gather together on a certain day at a certain place. So he fixed a day for them, and he also fixed a day and a place, both. Consequently, the women gathered together and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to them and he instructed them in those matters which Allah had taught him. And part of what he said to them was that if a woman from you has sent forth three children in her lifetime, then on the Day of Judgment these children will be a barrier for her against hellfire. Meaning if three of her children die in her lifetime, if a woman loses three of her children, then those children will be a barrier for her on the Day of Judgment from what? From the hellfire. Meaning they will shield her from the fire. She won't go to hellfire because of those three children that she lost. A woman from among them questioned, if two children have died? Meaning if a woman loses two children? And the woman repeated the word two. Right? She asked over and over again. So the Prophet ﷺ replied, yes, two also, two also, two also. That if a woman loses two children, then yes, even those two children will be a shield for her from the hellfire. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يرويه عن ربكم قال لكل عمل كفارة والصوم لي وأنا أجزي به والخلوف فم الصائم أطيب عند الله من ريح المسك رواه البخاري. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that Allah declares. And over here, عن النبي sallallahu alaihi wasallam, يَرْوِيهِ عَنْ رَبِّكُمْ يَرْوِيهِ عَنْ رَبِّكُمْ, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated this from your Lord. You know, riwayah, narration. So the scholars, the sahaba, when they narrated, they said, you know, so-and-so narrated to me from so-and-so. Okay? I heard from so-and-so, who heard from so-and-so, who heard from so-and-so, going all the way up to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this hadith is going all the way up to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Huraira said that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated this from your Lord. So what does this mean? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not just the Quran, but also something besides it, along with it. That Allah says, every deed has its reward, meaning good or bad. And fasting is for me. Thus, I myself will grant its reward. And the smell coming from the mouth of the fasting person is better in Allah's sight than the smell of musk. Why? Because fasting is for Allah. And Allah will reward the person for his fast. عن أنس رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يرويه عن ربه قال إذا تقرب العبد إلي شبرا تقربت إليه ذراعا وإذا تقرب مني ذراعا تقربت منه باعا وإذا أتاني مشيا أتيته هرولة رواه البخاري. Anas radiallahu anhu related from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that Allah declares. The Messenger of Allah narrated from who? His Lord. That whenever my servant comes towards me the length of a span, then I come towards him an arm's length. And if he draws near to me an arm's length, I draw near to him a fathom's length. When the servant comes to me walking, then I come to him running. Meaning, when a person draws closer to Allah, Allah draws even more closer to him. But who has to start? The person himself. He has to start. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الله عز وجل. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah azza wa jalla says that al-kibriya'u rida'i wal-'azamatu izari faman naza'ani wahidan minhuma qadaftuhu fin-nar rawahu Abu Dawud. Abu Huraira radhiyallahu anhu narrated from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that Allah says. Now Allah says, is it mentioned in the Quran? This statement? No. It's not mentioned in the Quran. That pride is my cloak and greatness is my robe, and he who competes with me in respect of either of them, I shall cast him into the hellfire. Meaning, if a person tries to be arrogant and great, then that person will be thrown into hellfire because he is competing with who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who deserves to have greatness? Only Allah. He is al-mutakabbir. So the one who tries to have takabbur, the one who tries to be great, then he will be thrown into the hellfire because he is competing with Allah. This is just like if a person is wearing a particular kind of a dress, okay? And other people, they imitate them. They start wearing the same kind of dress, or they want to. So they're in a way competing with that person. So you wear this nice dress, I will wear something even nicer. Okay? Now if you ever feel that another individual is copying you, imitating you in everything that you do, in everything that you have, you feel angry. Right? That you feel that this is not fair because you want to be unique. We are human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wahid al-ahad. Laysa kamithlihi shay'un, at all. And if people try to compete with him, trying to be great, then this does not befit them at all. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very upset with the person who tries to be great. So such a person will be thrown into the hellfire. Now these ahadiths in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned something that Allah says, but it's not mentioned in the Quran, it's not revealed in the Quran, then such ahadith are called hadith Qudsi. Okay? Quds is holy. So Qudsi meaning the hadith that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning this is what Allah has said. And hadith, by the way, literally means statement. So it's the statement from Allah. Next chapter. Chapter number 10. As-sunnatu was-sahabatu. Sunnah and the companions. So far we have learnt about the different kinds of sunnah. What the status of the sunnah is. Do we have to follow it or we don't have to follow it? Right? We have learnt about the wujub, the obligation of observing the sunnah. We have learned about also what the status is of one's own opinion or the opinion of any other individual when it comes to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Right? Now we are going to learn about the Sahaba, that how was their attitude towards the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. What was their attitude with the Sunnah of the Messenger ﷺ? Did they follow it or did they ignore it? Did they respect it or did they adore it? What was their dealing? How was their attitude towards the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? Is it important to know about their attitude with the Sunnah? Why is it important for us to know? Because we have to be like them. We have to be like them. They are an example for us. What's the evidence of that? رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah is happy with them and they are also happy with Him. Allah has revealed this Himself in the Qur'an. And Allah says in the Qur'an, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ. تُمْ, plural. That if the people believe as you all have believed. Not آمَنْتَ, meaning the Prophet ﷺ, but آمَنْتُمْ, you all, meaning Sahaba. So our iman, our amal has to be like that of the companions. So this is why we have to look at them, that how did they follow the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? What was their attitude with the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? Whatever they did, we are supposed to do the same. Precept number 59, the companions of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ endeavor to follow the sayings and the deeds of the Messenger of Allah ﷺ exactly as seen or heard from him. The Sahaba, we learn from their lives that they endeavored, they strove hard in order to stay close to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, in order to adhere firmly to it, in order to follow it exactly as the Sunnah was, exactly as they had heard the Prophet ﷺ or they had seen him do something. Then we learn that it is not necessary to understand the benefit and wisdom of a Sunnah in order to observe it. Benefit meaning the maslaha, and wisdom meaning the hikmah. Okay? That typically what do we think? That when we learn about a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, then we have to see what kind of sunnah is it? Is it mu'akkida? Is it ghair mu'akkida? Right? Is it emphasized? Or is it just something that's not that emphasized? What category does a sunnah fall in? Right? Likewise, we differentiate between the actions of the Prophet ﷺ. We categorize them that this action he performed because it was an act of worship. This action he performed because it was his natural habit. This action he performed because it was a cultural practice. Right? We differentiate between the actions of the Prophet ﷺ, you know, his practices. But the Sahaba, they didn't do anything like that. If they found out that the Prophet ﷺ did something, they did it. They didn't have to know the wisdom behind that sunnah. They didn't have to know the hikmah behind it, the maslaha behind it, the benefit, the reasoning, the logic. No. If the Prophet ﷺ did it, he said it, that is sufficient. That is enough as an evidence for us. It's best that you know the wisdom. It's best that you know the benefit because it helps you practice better. But remember, it's not necessary. So for example, if we know that the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, something that he emphasized, was that when we drink in three sips. Now, you can come up with a list of benefits behind that. You can come up with a list of hikmah behind that. But is it necessary for us to know the hikmah, the maslaha? No. What is enough for us? That he did it, he said it. That is sufficient. And if we follow the sunnah in this way, then only can we be of those who do ittiba'u sunnah, who truly follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Because if we wait to understand, to know the wisdom, then we might not be following the Prophet ﷺ, we might be following our brains. You understand? Or our logic. But we have to follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And also remember that the list of benefits and the reasons that people may be coming up with, you know, one thing a person could mention and next day it could be refuted by scientific evidence. Isn't it so? Quite possible. So, do we rely on scientific evidence or do we rely on the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? The Sunnah. That's enough for us. عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال بينما رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي بأصحابه إذ خلع نعليه فوضعهما عن يساره فلما رأى ذلك القوم ألقوا نعالهم فلما قضى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صلاته قال ما حملكم على إلقاء نعالكم قالوا رأيناك ألقيت نعليك فألقينا نعالنا underline this رأيناك ألقيت نعليك فألقينا نعالنا فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن جبريل أتاني فأخبرني أن فيهما قذرا أو قال أذى وقال إذا جاء أحدكم إلى المسجد فلينظر فإن رأى في نعليه قذرا أو أذى فليمسحه وليصلي فيهما رواه أبو داود. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once leading the Sahaba in prayer when during the prayer he removed his shoes. He was leading the people in prayer and during the salah he removed his shoes from his left side and he put them on the side. So towards his left he put his shoes during the salah. When the companions noticed this, they also removed their shoes. Meaning they removed their shoes in the same manner just as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finished the prayer and inquired, why did you people remove your shoes? The companion said, we saw you removing your shoes, so we removed our shoes too. We saw you removing them, so we also removed them. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Jibreel came and pointed out that some impurity was attached to my shoes. This is the reason why I removed them. And then he advised the companions that when you come to the mosque to pray, then inspect your shoes thoroughly. If there is any impurity on them, then clean it and pray in your shoes. What do we see in this hadith? That the Sahaba followed the Prophet ﷺ without knowing the reason, the wisdom behind why he removed his shoes. All they saw was that he removed his shoes, so they did the exact same thing. They didn't say, okay, you know what, after the prayer we're going to ask him. After the prayer, we'll ask him, why did he remove his shoes? Is it wrong to wear shoes in salah? We'll ask him later. Right now, let's just pray. No. They knew, they understood that whatever the Prophet ﷺ does, you follow that. Whatever he commands, you do that. You have to follow him. So that's what they did. They didn't have time to question him, to ask him to know the reason, the benefit. No. And this is exactly what we are supposed to do as well. Follow the sunnah once we come to know about it. And later on, he asked them, that, why did you remove your shoes? I removed them just because, you know, my shoes were impure. There was some impurity on my shoes and Jibreel came and told me. So this is the reason why he did that. Now there are a number of things that we learn in this hadith. First of all, we see that it is permissible to wear shoes during salah. But what's the condition? That they have to be clean. Now you might say, how do you know? We were walking outside. We don't know. Remember that something will be considered clean unless proven otherwise. Okay? So if, for example, your shoes are wet, let's say you were walking from the bus stop all the way to your house, and you want to pray in your shoes, and let's say it was raining, alright? And your shoes are wet, and you know that many dogs were out for their walks, so it's quite possible that where you stepped, Allahu A'lam, there might have been some impurity there which got onto your shoes, so your shoes are still wet basically. So you won't pray in them. But if your shoes become dry, especially after you have walked through mud, okay? Mud is different than your concrete floors, okay? Mud. If you walk through mud, then your shoes are clean. But if they're just wet, you don't know what that wetness is, you know, you will wait until they dry, or you will dry them. Like in the hadith it is said, فَلِيَمْسَحْهُ. Then he should wipe them clean. So the condition is that the shoes have to be clean. And we also learned that in the masjid, is it permissible to wear shoes? You basically have to follow the protocol. If you are at a place where there's carpet, there are clean floors that have been swept and mopped and everything, then you're not going to bring your shoes in. You're going to leave your shoes outside at the shoe rack, whatever the rules are. So you have to follow protocol. Okay? But if you are at a place where the ground is such that it's all mud or it's sand, and people do wear shoes and there is no problem. The masjid of the Prophet ﷺ was such that the floor, the ground was not concrete. And there were times when the ground would be extremely hot. very hot. So this is the reason why they would have their shoes on even during the prayer. Then likewise, if it rained, then the ground would be muddy. Okay? So that's also why they would keep their shoes on. So it is permissible. Musa alayhi salam, he was told when he went up on the mountain to speak to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, فَخْلَعْنَ عَلَيْكَ, remove your shoes. What was the reason given? إِنَّكَ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ طُوَى, that you are in the sacred valley, in the clean, in the pure, in the clean place. So yes, out of respect, out of adab, we do remove our shoes. Because generally shoes are not that clean. I mean, even if there's no impurity on them, still, you know, they have mud or whatever on them. But if for a reason you have to keep your shoes on, then there is no harm. As long as you are following the protocol. Okay? عن ابن أبي رافع قال استخلف مروان أبا هريرة على المدينة وخرج إلى مكة فصلى لنا أبو هريرة الجمعة فقرأ بعد سورة الجمعة في الركعة الآخرة إذا جاءك المنافقون قال فأدركت أبا هريرة حين انصرف فقلت له إنك قرأت بسورتين كان علي بن أبي طالب يقرأ بهما بالكوفة فقال أبو هريرة إني سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقرأ بهما يوم الجمعة رواه مسلم. Ibn Abu Rafi' said that Marwan appointed Abu Huraira radhiyallahu anhu as governor in charge and himself went to Mecca on some work. So Marwan, he appointed Abu Huraira radhiyallahu anhu as the governor of Medina and he himself went to Mecca for some work. So that means who was in charge? Marwan. So in his absence, he appointed Abu Huraira as the in charge. During this period, Abu Huraira radhiyallahu anhu led the Friday prayer. In the first rakah, he recited Surah Al-Jumu'ah, and in the second rakah, he recited Surah Al-Munafiqun. Ibn Abu Rafi', he stated that after the prayer, I asked Abu Huraira that you have recited the same surahs which Ali radhiyallahu anhu used to recite in Kufa. Meaning, Ali radhiyallahu anhu in Kufa, when he was a Khalifa and he would lead Salat Al-Jumu'ah, this is what he used to recite in the first rakah, Surah Al-Jumu'ah, and in the second rakah, Surah Al-Munafiqun. So Abu Huraira stated that I have heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam reciting these surahs in the Friday prayers. This is why I recited them. I'm not reciting them because Ali radhiyallahu anhu used to, I'm reciting them because Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to. And if Ali radhiyallahu anhu did that, he did it why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did that. Now what does it show? That the companions, they followed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to such detail. If he recited a particular surah in a particular salah, they also recited the same surah in that salah. You understand? If you think about it, in salah you can read any surah. In the Jumu'ah prayer, you can read any surah. But the sahaba, they prayed their salah even as close as possible to the sunnah of the Prophet. Now you might ask, is it wajib to recite these two surahs? Is it mustahab? Is it fard? You can ask these questions. But what will tell you to recite these surahs? Huh? Love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ittiba'u sunnah. The desire to follow him. That will convince you to recite these surahs. This was the way of the companions as well. عن نافع قال سمع ابن عمر رضي الله عنه مزمارا قال فوضع إصبعيه على أذنيه ونأى عن الطريق وقال لي يا نافع هل تسمع شيئا قال فقلت لا قال فرفع إصبعيه من أذنيه وقال كنت مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فسمع مثل هذا فصنع مثل ذلك. And this hadith continues, there is one more statement, that قال نافع فكنت إذ ذاك صغيرا. نافع narrated that I was walking along with Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Why do you think he was walking along with him? Do you know their relationship? That Nafi was the freed slave of Abdullah ibn Umar. It is said that Nafi, he was very intelligent. And Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu saw the potential in him. That he can learn a lot and he can benefit the Ummah a lot. But at the same time, Nafi was, he had a lot of other interests. Okay, and this happens with many people who have talent, that they have to do something with their time. Isn't it? So they get busy with one thing after the other. So he had a lot of skills, a lot of talent, and he kept himself busy with different things. But then what happens? When you get busy with other things, then what you could do much better, you tend to ignore that. So Nafir also compromised on his learning because he was spending his time doing other things. So it is said that Abdullah ibn Umar used to tie him up so that he couldn't make anything, couldn't go anywhere, couldn't do anything else. He was bound to one place. All he could do was learn, hear, memorize. Okay? And this is why we had this treasure. He had the golden chain of narration. The golden chain, silsilatul dhahab. The very few number of narrators between Imam Malik learned from Nafir, Nafir learned from Abdullah ibn Umar, who learned from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Over such a long period of time, only two people in the middle. So this happens with us as well, that Allah has blessed us with time, with talent, with a lot of abilities, and we want to do a lot of things. But there are some things that are essential. We have to give them our 100%, and we have to cut out the rest of the things in order to focus on them. You know, my mother, she also tells us about how she loved to, you know, stitch and paint and, you know, knit and embroider and all of these things. And her father saw the potential in her. And she said, whenever I would make some painting or stitch something or knit or weave, he would say, other people are also doing this. Other people also do this. Now you should do what others don't do. You can buy these things from stores even. You can buy stitched clothes, but you can't buy knowledge. You have to learn yourself. Isn't it so? So for that, you literally have to lock yourself up. And if somebody else locks you up, they are your muhsin. Okay? If somebody else locks you up, that they say, no computer, no phone calls, no going out. 5 days a week you're going to school. And when you come home, you have to do your lesson 7 times. You're not going anywhere. Then remember, they are your muhsin. They are doing you a huge favor. A huge favor. And you will thank them later. So Nafir, he said that he was once walking along with Abdullah ibn Umar, and Abdullah ibn Umar heard the sound of a flute. What is flute? A musical instrument, right? So Abdullah ibn Umar, when he heard that sound, he inserted his fingers in both his ears. Why? So that he could not hear that music. And he proceeded far on the other side of the road to go as far as possible from the sound of that music. And then he inquired, he asked, oh Nafir, are you hearing anything? Do you hear anything? Meaning, do you still hear that? So he said, nothing. Nafir said, no, I don't hear it anymore. So then Abdullah ibn Umar removed his fingers from his ears and said, I was with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he heard the sound of a flute, and he did the same thing as I did now. He did the same thing, so this is why I am also doing this. Now you might ask, but you're not actually listening to music. You're just hearing it, right? Because there is a difference between hearing and listening. A person might say, I'm not listening, I'm just hearing because that sound is there. I don't want to listen. People are playing it. What can I do? It's not within my control. Is it fard to put your fingers in your ears? Is it mustahab to put your fingers in your ears? You can ask such questions. But Abdullah ibn Umar, he just did what he saw the Prophet ﷺ doing. He put his fingers in his ears, so I will do the same thing. عن هلال بن يساف قال كنا مع سالم بن عبيد فعطس رجل من القوم فقال السلام عليكم فقال السلام عليك وعلى أمك ثم قال بعد لعلك وجدت مما قلت لك قال لوددت أنك لم تذكر أمي بخير ولا بشر قال إنما قلت لك كما قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إنا بينا نحن عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا عطس رجل من القوم فقال السلام عليكم فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وعليك وعلى أمك ثم قال إذا عطس أحدكم فليحمد الله قال فذكر بعض المحامد وليقل له من عنده يرحمك الله وليرد يعني عليهم يغفر الله لنا ولكم رواه أبو داود. Hilal ibn Yasaf narrated that we were once with Salim bin Ubaid when a man from among the people sneezed. And when he sneezed, he said, Assalamu alaikum. What should he have said? Alhamdulillah. Now either he didn't know, he forgot, or you know sometimes you intend to say Alhamdulillah, but Subhanallah comes out of your mouth. Or Astaghfirullah comes out of your mouth. So Allahu a'lam, whether it was because he didn't know or it was an accident, right? Accidentally he said, Assalamu alaikum. So Salim, he said, وَعَلَيْكَ وَعَلَىٰ أُمِّكَ. He said, yes, and salam be upon you and also on your mother. Now, when he said, yes, salam be on you and also on your mother, now this man who sneezed and said, assalamu alaikum, he felt a little uncomfortable. So Salim said, perhaps you found something annoying from what I said to you? That man said, I wish you would not mention my mother with good or evil. I mean, why are you mentioning my mother here? So he said, I have just said to you what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said. He said, once we were in the presence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when a man among the people sneezed and he said, assalamu alaykum. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, wa alayka wa ala ummika, that salam be on you and also on your mother. And then he said that when one of you sneezes, he should praise Allah. Meaning he should say, alhamdulillah. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said at that occasion. And he further mentioned some words of praise of Allah. And then he said that the one who is with him should say to him, yarhamukallah. Meaning, may the mercy of Allah be upon you. And he should reply to them that, yaghfirullahu lana wa lakum. Meaning, may Allah forgive us and you. So what do we see in this hadith? That Salim bin Ubayd, he said the exact same thing that he heard the Prophet ﷺ saying to a person when he said, assalamu alaikum, in place of alhamdulillah. Now, technically, if you think about it, it seems like, you know, the Prophet ﷺ was being humorous at that occasion, right? That he said, okay, wa alayka wa ala ummika. Because when you hear such a response, all of a sudden you're like, did I say something wrong? Was I not supposed to say that? But we see that Salim and Ubayd, he repeated the exact same thing again. Even the answer that he gave what he heard from the Prophet ﷺ. He didn't have to. He could have said that, oh, brother, you're supposed to say alhamdulillah, not assalamu alaikum. But he said the same thing that he heard the Prophet ﷺ say. Why? Because this is ittiba' al-sunnah. This is following the Prophet ﷺ. عَنْ نَافِعٍ أَنَّ رَجْلًا عَطَصَ إِلَى جَنْبِ إِبْنِ عُمَرَ فَقَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ قال ابن عمر وأنا أقول الحمد لله والسلام على رسول الله وليس هكذا علمنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم علمنا أن نقول الحمد لله على كل حال رواه الترمذي. نافع narrated that a person sneezed before Abdullah ibn Umar and he said الحمد لله والسلام على رسول الله. الحمد لله and peace be upon the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Abdullah ibn Umar, he said to him, I also say alhamdulillah wassalamu ala rasulillah, meaning I have no objection, you know, against the statement. The statement in meaning, it's perfectly fine. But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has not taught us this. That when we sneeze, he didn't teach us that we should say that. Instead, he taught us that after sneezing, we should say alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. So what do we see here? That ittiba'u sunnah means following the Prophet ﷺ exactly as he did or said. Not less, definitely, and not even more. Because if you think about it, the statement, alhamdulillah wassalamu ala rasulillah, it's very good in its meaning, isn't it? The meaning is perfect. There's nothing wrong in it. In fact, it's beautiful. But this is not what the Prophet ﷺ taught the people. This is not what he said. This is not what he taught. So this is why we are not going to say it. All right? Remember that there is a principle, which is that something that has been narrated from the Prophet ﷺ, we should keep it as it is. Whether it is narrated in the Sunnah or it is mentioned in the Quran, we should keep it as it is. We don't add anything else to it in order to beautify it more. Even if the addition is perfect in its meaning. Okay? For example, in the Quran, we learn the dua, رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Now a person might say, but say, رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا وَحِكْمًا وَعَمَلًا. Right? You could go on and you might say, yes. So beautiful if you say, oh Allah, increase me in my knowledge, increase me in my wisdom, increase me in my action. Very beautiful meaning. Nice dua. But when something has been narrated, then adding to that does not make it more beautiful. Rather, keeping it as it is important. Why? Why do you think so? Because if you add more, then you are getting ahead of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there's nothing wrong with the meaning, so what's the big deal? What's the big deal then? There will be confusion between people. People will not know what is masnoon and what is not masnoon. The sunnah will get lost. The original will get lost. And let me give you an example. You know the Jumu'ah khutbah? At the beginning of the khutbah, the imam, he recites, alhamdulillah. Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu, wa nasta'inuhu, wa nastaghfiruhu. But have you also heard, wa nu'minu bihi, wa natawakkalu alayhi, wa natubu. Right? Have you heard all of this? Now, you hear so many different variations. Tell me which is masnoon and what is added. You don't know why, because there's so many additions. And sometimes, some khutbah, you hear so many additions. You're like, wow, amazing. But you know what? Because of that, the original masnoon khutbah, that has been lost. In the sense that people don't know unless they study it in books. Correct? So this is an important lesson, an important principle in the deen. That whatever has been manqul, meaning whatever has been narrated, whatever has been transmitted to us, we keep it as it is. We don't add to it. Masnoon khutbah, you can Google it, inshallah you'll find it. Okay? And also remember that it's against adab. That if the Prophet ﷺ said a statement, that for example when we sneeze, we say Alhamdulillah. Or maximum we say Alhamdulillahi ala kulli hal. But if we don't say that, and instead we say something else, then what are we leaving? His statement. So this is kind of disrespect to the Prophet ﷺ. So ittibar is complete ittibar. Not less and not more. Once people have the courage to start adding things to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, even if it's correct in meaning, soon others will have the courage to add things to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ which are not even correct. Okay, so this paves the way to bid'ah, to innovation. This leads to innovation. And about innovation, it is said that al-bid'atu tumitu sunnah. That bid'ah gives death to the sunnah. It kills the sunnah. It takes its place completely. So this is the way of the Sahaba, that they followed the Prophet ﷺ exactly. Not less, not more. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.